Welcome back to the Shane Plays Let's Play series of Torment Tides of Numenera. We are currently exploring the Cliff's Edge.
I should really get moving before someone tries to kill me.
The Cliff's Edge area of Sagas Cliffs. So, kind of cleared out some of this. We still need to check out this tavern. And what else do we need to check out? Some areas over here. So, still work to be done. Exploring to do. So let's talk to Jernaw. This old man's skin is covered in makeup, painstakingly drawn to resemble dark stone. His eyes widen briefly as he notices you, and his face and neck hardens into actual obsidian for a moment. Then he smiles and nods at you, his features mobile once more. Oh, that's interesting. Welcome, welcome, he says. Sorry about the stone. Polymorphic flesh modification, you see. I didn't see you walk up and assumed you were going to cut my throat and take my chirurgical parlor for yourself. So chirurge, whatever chirurge is. I feel like I should know that word. Hey, the day's young. I'm going to say, why would you think such a thing? I do good business here, the old man shrugs. If I were a younger man looking to make a name for myself in this city, I'd kill me too. My chirurgical parlor is a marvel of the prior world, you see. Just pick an item or a service, pay my outrageous fees, and after only a short to long period of fairly safe but indescribable agony, you walk away with some horrible Numenera bits whirring away inside you. He pokes a few buttons on the device strapped to his wrist, and lights twinkle across its length. A dark, glassy lens focuses on you. Well, interested? I can't help noticing that you're a very honest man. Well spotted, he says, nodding. Clear streaks of quartz run up his prominent cheekbones, revealing the muscle beneath. It's a side effect of my modifications. Couldn't lie to you if you begged me to. He shrugs. Honesty is usually a hindrance to a businessman, but people seem to like it. How did you come to own this parlor? It was originally a partnership, he says. My colleagues and I spent 2 years digging it out and getting the whole mess working. Of course, we had to test the drones before we tried them on anyone else. Customers getting skinned alive on opening day is bad for business. Turns out that was a wise move. Gorna chose an intelligence modification, and the drones cut off his head to work on it more directly. Mior picked strength, and the drones sliced off her arms. They defaulted to sever in those days. He smiles fondly. Anyway, 6 partners later, I was the sole proprietor. I worked out the kinks, and here we are. With no fatalities in, he thinks, months. No fatalities in months. Show me your list of items and services. Of course, he says, tapping a few buttons on the broad device encircling his wrist. The lens beams a cone of light directly under your eye, which immediately begins watering. Blinking, you see a menu of items seemingly hanging in the air. Oh my goodness. Wow. The clawed gauntlets. I knew that would catch your eye, he says, digging you in the ribs. We plant long hollow rods into your forearms and steel blades sheathed inside. Just flick your wrist and out they pop, surprising anyone who mistook you for unarmed. He demonstrates with his unoccupied wrist, making little shik sounds. 125 shins for the weapon and the workbow. No thank you, I'm not allowed to what? Why can't I? No thank you. Your loss, he says, interested in anything else? Really, I can't buy that? I totally want that. Anyway, the jagged memory. This, he says with a raised finger, is a tricky one. It's a mesh that fuses through your skin, leaving jagged marks like tattoos. When you attack, you'll always hit your enemy's old wounds, even if they weren't there before. Told you it was a tricky one, he beams proudly. Yours for 110 shins. No thank you. Man, why can't I buy any of this stuff? The encroaching darkness? A beguiling name, isn't it? He says, his laugh lines crinkling. I'm glad you like it because, I'm not quite sure what it does. It's a living creature, you see, that crawls around your body while you sleep. Eventually, it takes root in your nervous system and does something. He shrugs. Could be bad. Could be both. Or could be good. Could be bad. Could be both. It certainly won't be boring. 100 shins. No, thank you. Man. I can't get the encroaching darkness out of my head. What are blood nanites? It's quite simple, he says. The drones fill your blood with millions of tiny machines that promptly begin devouring you alive until they learn to differentiate between your body and anything that's not supposed to be in there. After that, they'll do their level best to purge toxins and illnesses from your body with every pump of your heart. He pauses. In case I wasn't clear, this one was really going to hurt. 95 shins paid in advance, please. No, thank you. The Numenera analyzer sounds safest. It's quite safe, he says, nodding, most of the time, in almost 3 out of 5 cases. And the procedure couldn't be simpler. The drone simply saw your skull open, shove an implant into the right spot, and seal everything back up again. He clasps his hands. Once they do that, the implant will help you identify the purpose of unknown Numenera. It costs 95 shins, but it pays for itself. No, thank you. An artificial eyeball? Really? Very popular item, he says, nodding. The meat ones wear out so easily. This one never does, and it'll help you spot things normal eyes miss. All it takes is a one-time cost of 110 shins and a tremendously unpleasant operation. No, thank you. Wow, how painful are these? How painful are these procedures? That is a popular question, he says, and it does vary from procedure to procedure. But if you're seeking a general idea, he taps his thin thoughtfully. My customers usually range between shrieking for a merciful death and groaning while soiling themselves, if that helps. But they almost always seem happy with the results when they survive. Now, are you ready to buy something? Oh, man, I don't know. Can I ask you about something else? Show me your list of items. I got to be honest. I want those Wolverine claws. I mean, let's be honest. I might be interested in the clawed gauntlets after all. Ah, the hidden wrist blades. 125 shins. Why can't I buy anything from this guy? All I can say is no thank you. Am I out of money? Farewell. How much money do I have? I've got 51 shins. Okay, I need to go sell some stuff. I want those stupid Wolverine claws. I'm not even joking. Okay, so I guess I don't have enough money. Let me go here. What is this? These shelves abound with beakers, flasks, and other myriad containers. The utter lack of labels on any of them is somewhat worrying. I like this. This looks cool up here. This display shows information regarding patients, conveniently visible from anywhere within the parlor. So yeah, there's little beds here that you can lay on. Let's see here. Let's talk to this drone.
I'll be honest. You terrify me.
This small mechanical chirurgeon is roughly the size of your head. At the end of one of its arms, a trio of slender, razor-sharp blades flicks at the air. It's not clear whether it's trying to sense you or warning you to keep your distance. Examine the drone. The drone buzzes a warning at you as you lean in for a closer look. The retractable blades leap to your attention. A tiny shaft of light graces the edge of each one, and they taste the air like tiny tongues. But you also notice a panel beneath the blades, fluttering like an insect's wing. Beneath, you catch a glimpse of a row of sawtooth injectors. All right, leave it alone. All right, what is this? The books jamming the shelves of this desk are divided equally between obscure medical text and mechanical how-to model. Mechanical how-to manuals. Right, this looks kind of bloody and not so encouraging. What else is going on over here? I gotta be honest. If I had the money, I'd buy those Wolverine claws. I've just gotta be honest. The shape of this operating table provides little information regarding the physiology of the beings it was originally designed to treat. So I'm gonna look up really quick chirurgical. I feel like I should know what that word is. So let's look here. I'm just going to pause the video and I'll be right back. Okay, so chirurgical, it's an archaic word that means of or relating to surgery, surgical. So it's just kind of a different way, old-fashioned way of saying surgery, surgical. I'm kind of down with having some of this done. I mean, I'm sure I'll save right before I do it. Let me talk to this glaive. Got a discount eye implanted in a bar once. Saw nothing but walls of pickles for 3 days. Huh, that's weird.
Naturally.
All right. Pico. What's up, Pico? The mutant boy gazes at the entrance to the chirurgical parlor, flinching at each scratch of razor metal on metal from within. By your estimation, he is in his late teens, but is the size of a young, malnourished child. His arms are little more than bone wrapped in red speckled skin, and a raw line zigzags down between his mismatched eyes and over his blade of a nose, as if pointing directly at his thin lips. He sees you looking, and bird-like muscles flex in his frail jaw. Get a good look, he says, lifting his chin. Or maybe you want to call me some names? I hear eggshell a lot. Or maybe lightning bolt? I get that one from time to time. He crosses his bony arms and glares at you. Don't let me stop you. Call me some names. Laugh. Do it now, because in another few minutes, I'll be the one laughing. Calm down, Earthquake. I'm not going to say that. I'm not laughing, and I'm sorry if I offended you. Yeah. I don't want your apologies. He sighs. You didn't offend me. Believe me, I'm used to this by now. I'm not going to be the butt of everyone's jokes anymore, he says. Electricity sizzles within the nearby parlor. This time, he does not flinch away. Lighting flickers trapped in his determined eyes. I have some money, all right. I'm going to use it to change myself. Change everything I can. He trails off, studying you in turn. His eyes widen, and he glances quickly away, studying the nearby parlor instead. What sort of changes are you considering? What do you care? He says. I'm sure you have business somewhere in the city. I don't want to be in any trouble. Why did you look at me strangely earlier? His mouth trembles as though he's wrestling with a question he doesn't want to ask. Doesn't feel good to be stared at, does it? He says at last, looking back at the parlor. He seems to be deflecting your question, although it isn't clear why. Why did you look at me strangely earlier? I just looked at you, that's all. You're imagining things. All right. Can everyone buy improvements from the parlor? Yes, he says. You pay the keeper and the drones will make your body the way you want. Why did you look at me strangely? I just looked at you. Okay, farewell. All right, let's see here.
It is done.
Let's see if I can't sell some stuff and get some implants. I'll have to come back here. What's up, Barant? Barant, what's your name? I'm not much of a talker, but I like listening. Guromo, fidgets. Surprise briefly registers on the cultist's face when she sees you. The name is Etasi. Then she slightly inclines her head in respect. Greetings, beloved vessel. How may I help you? You seem less deferential than some of the other cultists. Why? Not all of us revere your father, she says carefully. We simply honor him for his boundless wisdom and bottomless knowledge. We wish to emulate him. She clears the throat. But worship him? No. Good day to you. To you as well, beloved vessel.
Absolutely.
What else is going on down here? Okay, so this is the guy who's getting people riled up over that. There's a stichus over, where is it at? It's like way over here, and it's like mutated and not evidently not as dangerous as some of the other ones, and this guy's rabble-rousing. So the stichus are, they're not evil, but if you haven't seen previous videos or played the game, they're under the city, and they naturally tunnel and dig, and they're making this part of the city unstable, and houses and buildings are falling into the chasm below, and people are dying, and, you know, it's kind of a bad situation. Let's talk to this Dinger or her cultist. The flesh creeps if you let it. If you let it,
I'm
yeah,
there,
you're creepy, bro.
In the shadows.
All right. Mercenary. What's up, mercenary? Grrr. All these people. I saw it sneaking around Oskara's place. They're all there. I heard some rustling inside that crashed airship. The stichus must be stopped. His lordship knows what's best for us. Count on it. So there's just a bunch of... But what does Stichus want in Cliff's Edge? Wonder if he's going to offer a bounty. I'd take it in a second. So it's just general crowd talk. Let's talk to Lord Wundgen. Lord Wundgen. Declaiming to the crowd is a well-dressed but sickly-looking man. Short, dumply, and an unhealthy shade of yellow. Despite this, he has the proud demeanor and the stentorian voice of a much larger man. He booms at you as you approach. Ah, another likely fellow. Excellent. The people have called for deliverance from this ravaging stichus, and a hero has answered. Most courageous of you. Matkina, I know this man. He has hired me many times and paid me nearly as often. Lord Wundgen. He smiles. All you have to do is be the first to find the rogue stichus that's been terrorizing Cliff's Edge. Return here and tell me precisely where it is, and I'll take it from there. He pats you on the shoulder. And you'll be rewarded, I promise you. As the head of a slave family, I owe you a favor. And my favor carries a good deal of weight. I'm not gonna say I know where it is. I'm not gonna say I found it, but it's harmless. I'm gonna say, can I ask you more about the stichus and its kind? Of course. Knowing the enemy is the first step to defeating it. What exactly is a stichus? They are horrible, undermining vermin from another world. They tunnel beneath the streets of our city, undermining our homes, and causing them to collapse. Our deaths are nothing to them. They don't even believe that humans are sentient creatures. What else can you tell me about the rogue stichus you're looking for? He shudders. The vile thing appeared in Cliff's Edge a few days ago, and it's been skulking around ever since. The whole neighborhood lives in fear of it. How did the stichus come to be in Sagas Cliffs? Several members of the council believe that it's the work of our enemies, that their eggs were brought here from another world, an act of vengeance or sabotage, perhaps. Others think that the eggs were always here, and it took them centuries to hatch. He shrugs. But how doesn't matter to me. They're here, and they're dangerous, and it's up to every true citizen of Sagas Cliffs to resist them. Why is Cliff Edge so afraid of the stichus? Some will tell you it's because this district has suffered the most from the stichus digging, houses collapsing on the people, others falling into the sea. There's some truth to that, but the real reason is that the people here have become weak and afraid. They aren't prepared to face adversity. He leans in, warming to his subject. Indeed, if the stichus didn't exist, I would be tempted to invent them, for they are just what the city needs to stiffen its spine. Sagas Cliffs, our once proud empire, has abandoned its holdings and ceded its territories to autochthonous tribes and wild beasts. It's time to take them back. But how can we do that when our citizens have become lazy, timid children? Let's see. But empires only serve the interests of a lucky few. You're right. Without conflict, people grow complacent. The people aren't weak. They only need someone to lead them and aspire them toward a common goal. I'm going to say Sagas Cliffs had an empire. Indeed. We held all the lands from here to Ornu's Unagrin. That was before the slave uprising that brought the slave families to power. Some of us seek to reclaim what we lost. I'm going to say the people aren't weak. They only need someone to lead them, to inspire them toward a common goal. And when that leader is gone, the city will fall back into apathy. No, an enemy is what this city needs. In strife, we discover our finest selves. So it has always been. Can I ask you something else? Tell me about yourself. He puts a hand to his chest and raises his chins. I am Yars Vuntgen of House Vuntgen, one of the most respected of the slave families. I also have the honor of serving on the council. He looks around him uneasily. I don't usually descend into this neighborhood, but in such a crisis, one must put one's finer feelings aside and do what one can for one's city. All right. I don't want to ask who the same families are, you know. All right, farewell.
All right.
I'm not planning on giving the stichus up. What is this way? I don't want to leave yet. Where does that go? It goes to Circus Minor.
Of course.
Let's go down here and talk to this guy. Eretus. The first thing you notice about this wiry young man is the golden haze, the glow surrounding him. It sparkles in his eyes and gives his easy grin a warmth that you can feel right down to your gut. He spots you and straightens.
I know what you're thinking. How in the world did you survive that crash, Eretus? The answer is, as it always is, backflips. But hold on. How did you know my name? Never mind. Not important. Of course you know my name. I'm Eretus.
Interesting. He plants his hands on his skinny hips and beams. I know there was a guy that stole an airship. So, same guy? Let's see. How did you end up crashing the airship? I'm glad you asked. This is somewhat of an understatement. He looks ecstatic. I was climbing up the cliffs to Caravanserai to see how impossible it was when I saw a star falling toward the reef. He raises an earnest finger. I knew right then that finding that star was my destiny. He runs his hands through his curls. But what was I going to do? Climb down? Boring. Already did it the other way. Walk? Walk? Worse. Far worse. No fun at all.
I'll remember that.
He grins. Then I saw the airship docked over my head. I raced on up, borrowed the ship, and pointed it right at the reef. His face falls. I don't know what happened next. Despite my expert piloting, the airship steered itself directly at the cliffs. I had no choice. I landed it as fast and hard as and safely as possible. Shaking his head, he sighs. I never did find that falling star. At this point, someone else has found it, and it's their destiny now. You're in luck. That falling star was me. No! Arita shouts overjoyed. Yes? Really? It was really you? He grabs you by both shoulders. This is fate. You are meant to travel with me. You have to. Don't say no. Why should I let you join me? He gives you a puzzled look, as if you just wondered aloud why air is important. I'm an adventurer, he repeats, brow furrowed. I thought I told you. Adventure happens when I'm around, and you'll get to be a part of it. He raises a finger, but you'll have to keep up where we go. He stares at the invisible horizon. We go swiftly, strongly, and most of all, handsomely. He leans in conspiratorially. Until you get handsome, I'll cover for the both of us. Maybe you can join me another time. I already have too many people with me. Really? I didn't... he looks past you. He and sees Matt Keener for what is apparently the first time. His jaw drops. What? Why are you looking at me like that? Baratus takes a breath and tries again. He explains with the expression of a drowning man. His golden aura pulses, possibly in time with his heartbeat. She stares at him, unblinking, and turns to you. Why is he looking at me like that? I could hazard a guess, but I don't think I need to. She glares at you, trying to decipher your devilish clue. Understanding dawns along with a slow, creeping horror. Don't, she says to Aretas. Really, don't. In so much as I have a type, you aren't it. Aretas takes a shuddering gasp, blinks with what appears to be every muscle in his body, and rips his gaze from Etkina. Well, what were we talking about? The owner of that airship wants to have a word with you. That's strange, he says, sweeping a lock of blonde hair out of his eyes. I already talked to him once. I was explaining to him how I needed to borrow an airship. He said no, so I waited until he wasn't looking and borrowed it anyway. He trails off, his golden glow diminishing slightly. A troubling thought wrestles its way onto his face. He's not angry, is he? He is very angry with you. You should talk to him. I'm about to let this guy go. Oh, he can't do it. He's out. 70% with her. Yeah, we'll use that success. Oh, he says, staring at the ground. His glow fades further. If you think it's the right thing to do. He blinks and a wide smile spreads over his face. His aura flares like a star. Yes, it is the right thing to do, and I'm going to do it. I'm going to right this wrong. He strides off towards Caravanserai, whistling cheerfully.
Making a note.
I would really like to recruit him. I want him in my... Kind of reminds me of a Tasselhoff. Burfoot. Okay, from Dragonlance. What is this now? Let's take a look at my journal. The Airship Thief. Oh, did I finish it? Nope, haven't finished it yet. Bring Aretas back to Master Reneo. I should meet with them, see if they resolve their dispute. I certainly will, because I want to recruit him. What is this? Airships are known to be nearly uncrashable due to their leisurely cruising speeds and simplified controls. This crash must have taken a rather unique confluence of events to occur. Alright. What is up with this trapdoor? The hatch appears to be the only visible means to enter the building. It's firmly sealed.
Enjoy killing for money? Seems like it could get depressing.
It's a job. And don't mercenaries kill people from time to time?
Yes, but only when the brothels close. We have standards.
All right, let's go talk to Mother Tamaz. This woman glares at the air above her head, her fingers fretting with a single bead in a long, peculiar chain of them. Her low, angry muttering resolves into words as you get closer. Foolish boy, shivering at the crossroads, mazed by your choices. Go on and pick beauty, pick strength, pick pleasure, whatever that be. The particulars don't matter, boy. What matters is the choosing and that you do it. The particulars matter quite a bit, I'd say. Who are you speaking to? She blinks at the empty air, and her hands steel to a metallic, many-faceted bead near the end of the chain. Not you, she says, snorting. But I may as well be. Mother Tamaz knows you, lad. Born falling you were, born in flame, shreds of your smoldering call streaming through the air. When you struck ground, your bead first went cold, then hotter than a mother's hatred. She shakes her head and spits at her feet. Scarcely born you are and learning quick, but you're still uncertain. All boys and girls are until they start making choices and dealing with the consequences, till they accept the cost of being adults. How do you know who I am? That's no mystery, lad, she says, flapping her hands at you. Have your bead, don't I? Formed it from a pinch of the call. I hear your thoughts as clear as moonlight in a cup. She sighs. You're confused, but that'll change. You'll have your feet under you soon enough. Not all of my children are as lucky.
I'll remember that.
Huh. This one, she says, showing you the bead she was speaking to you before you arrived. It's carved in the shape of a malformed ring. Pico wants to escape his past. He saved a handful of shins by honest means. That is to say, it's taken him a long time. And he's too busy pissing over the options to spend it. Her fingers fold over the bead. Push him into choosing a path, lad. Do that, and I'll return your call to you, improved through my art, stronger than when you lost it. I know where Pico at. I'll talk to him if I have time, but no promises. Please yourself, she says, with a sour look at the sky. Now I want to know about the call. You mentioned you had my call. That's not what it is. I'm not a fool boy, she says dryly. But you were born above my city, so I know you like or not. She reaches into the bag strapped to her hip. Something glitters within. This is your call, torn from you at birth. Name it what you will, but know what it be. Can I have a look at my call? When you finish the task, ask of you, not before. All right, farewell. I want to ask you about someone in particular. Oh, interesting. A note of wary caution enters Mother Temaz's voice, and she drops the chain to coil snake-like into the palm of her hand. Ren. Yeah, I'm looking for Ren. You describe the girl you're seeking, and she runs the chain of beads through her loosely coiled fist. Didn't deliver her, she declares. Don't know her. She doesn't come from Cliff's Edge and may not be from Sagas neither. Lord Vuntken. He's a leader of one of the slave families, she says, studying her beads casually. Has a number of opinions, that boy. Some he shares, some he doesn't, but he's got them all the same. I have nothing more to say about the man, she adds, but head over there with your mind open. He'll be happy to fill it for you. Persuasion. You don't seem to like Lord Vuntken much. Can we trust it or not? 65. Let's give it a 70% chance.
Making a note.
She presses her lips together, eyes flickering between the distant lord and you. Yovaki bled on his mother's side, she says at last, so low you can barely hear her. I'll not turn my back on a girl in trouble, but I have no time for disgusting abhumans either. She shoots a poisonous look in the lord's direction. I'm not alone in that. If people knew what he was, it would be the end of his politicking for sure and certain. Interesting. Can you tell me about him again? As I said, in confidence, he has Yovaki blood in him. See it there in the yellow, sagging skin. Would be the end of him if people knew. How about Finzen? That boy makes a woman believe in gods with a soft spot for fools, she says, snorting. His mother survived a difficult birth, only to die from a scratch a few years later. His aunt raised him, if you can call it that. She shakes her head. The boy spent years working towards an early death alongside the scum of the city. Now he's a citizen and living the straight end up, she spits. Better than him or dead and forgotten. I have other questions. Go on, she says, saying. All right, farewell. Stay safe, my lad. Pretty sure, yeah, I've been here. Let's go back and talk to this guy again. I've learned that you're part Yovaki. Abandon your hunt for the stichus, or I'll tell the crowd. He hisses at you under his breath. You would use my family's shame against me? You poisonous hypocrite. And I'm sure you think yourself noble for doing it. He swallows. You know they'll kill me if they find out. Do you really want that on your conscience? I won't have it on my conscience as long as you do as I say and stop hunting the stichus.
I'm ready to learn something new.
He lowers his head, furious. Very well, I'll call it off. But this is not the end for us, friend. You will regret crossing me. Okay, interesting. He turns to the crowd. Citizens, it seems we're making no headway in the hunt for the stichus, so I am returning home. I suggest you all do the same. All right. I can't see. I guess the crowd has to disperse. Okay, it's like I can't control my character. Okay, let's go up here. We'll talk to old Piquo and see if we can help out this situation. All right, let's talk to Mr. Piquo here. Toys with his hands, setting the entrance to the chirurgical parlor from beneath his lowered brow. You're back, he says. Tension ripples through the studied calm of his voice. Good. Mother Tamaz sent me. I want to help. Oh, he says, blushing. She knows. Of course she knows. That means you know, too. He chews his lips. Fine. I'm scared, all right? I've had this ugly face, this body my entire life. I've saved up to change myself, my future. Maybe I can become strong enough to deal with the people who hurt me. Or maybe I can fix my face. I can do that, but then I'll still be small. Despite the anger in his voice, tears are shining at the corner of his eyes.
I'll remember that.
I can only use the machines in the parlor once, understand? It's too expensive. I spent years saving up all this money, and it's not enough to fix me. He opens his pouch to display a moderately impressive collection of coins. At all this money, Tiber glances over just in time to see the pouch open. His eyes bulge. Poor lad, he whispers. All that coin must be weighing him down. We should lighten his load. Before I say anything, I want to ask you some questions. All right, he scratches his hairless cheek. I want to know about your past. You already know everything important, he says. He isn't making eye contact. I don't care about where I came from. All right, the future is what matters. I can't help you make the best decision if you don't tell me about yourself. Keep succeeding.
I'll remember that.
Even at like 70-75% chances, I keep succeeding. Fine, Piquo groans. You asked, remember? He covers his eyes and begins speaking as fast as he can. My parents came to the city with a tribe of people like me. I was born in the underbelly. My first memory is of someone spitting on me. My only friend was a girl named Crooked Queek, and we had to play in an alley so the normal kids wouldn't hurt us. She's dead. She got killed by the serial killer in the underbelly. When I was 12, someone killed my father in a bar, and it wasn't even investigated. He blinks hard, staring at the parlor. So I left, and I haven't seen anyone from the tribe since. Let them live off scraps in the dark. I'd rather die up here than down there. How did you earn your money? A shin at a time, Piquo says proudly. I went from shop to shop asking for work. Some of them kicked me out, but others let me sweep once a week or cook. I've done nearly every job in the city at least once. A smile drops off his face. No one ever wanted me to stay, though. They thought I scared customers off. His mouth twists. They're probably right. I'm done asking about your past. I want to help you decide what to do with that money. All right. Further proof that money of all sorts is the root of every human misery, Tiber mumbles sagely. We should cheer the lad up by removing his golden chains. I went to speak with your friend Crooked Queek. Someone killed her recently. Yep.
I'm ready to pick my path.
Oh, he says softly. He folds his arms over his belly, holding himself. Oh, Queek. Beneath the tears, his eyes are iron. Nothing's changed down there. People kill us. Kill them, and nothing happens. I can't ever go back there. I can't be like this anymore. So Crooked Queek, there's a serial killer in this game, in the underbelly, and each day that goes by without you solving it, somebody else dies. And Crooked Queek, I think, was the second victim. So if I would have solved it quicker, Crooked Queek would have been alive. And I guess I could have gone and talked to her, but I didn't actually go talk to her, obviously. I'm going to say I could think of better uses for your money besides changing your appearance. Huh? He says, blinking rapidly. He thrusts out a belligerent lip. Like what? Strength fails, beauty fades. Use that money to get an education at the Order of Truth. Huh? So my friend Tiber can explain better than I can, so I could let Tiber steal his money, which I'm not going to do. Life is too short for worry. Use that money on something fun. Nope. I'm going to recommend that he go get an education at the Order of Truth. She's out. He's out. She's got... Okay, succeeded.
I'll remember that.
I know what you're saying, Pequot says, but I worked hard to save up my shins. Why should I give them to the Order of Truth? Oh, dearest, Calistine says, shaking her head. I understand. You want to escape your body. Who doesn't? But an education will do more than enrich your prospects. She waves a contemptuous hand at the chirurgical parlor. My colleague is correct. Flesh rots, dear. Our minds are the finer tool, the unbreakable one. I understand, Pico says, casting one last longing look at the parlor. I guess that's why I was hesitating. I didn't want to spend all that money to temporarily fix half my problem. He gives both of you a tentative smile. I'll talk to the Order. Thank you. I think I had people either level up or reach another tier. Yeah, two people here. Alright, so what does that say? Wayward son. Yeah, return to Mother Tamaz. Let's go back to Mother. Mother Tamaz, how should it be? I'm making this song up. I should have let it free? I don't know. Okay. Mother Tamaz. What now, my lad? I need to talk to you about Pequot. Eh, what of him? I've solved his problem. Have you? Mother Temez's eyes unfocus, and her fingers trace the borders of the hollow bead. Mayhap you did, she says at last. An education will last him a lifetime. Or until his mind fails him, as it does some. She shakes her head. I know you did what you thought was right. But I wonder if the lad will use what he learns to overthink his problems from higher up. She roots about in a saddlebag hanging at her hip. Take the call, lad. You earned it.
I'll remember that.
Call shield. Nice. Off with you. You've done enough here. So I got 25 XP and a call shield. Let's look at this thing. Plus 15 evasion, plus 2 might pool. Only usable by me. Nice. She claimed to have found the membrane that protected you during your birth in the skies over Saga's cliffs. She used the membrane to cap a shield that is transparent and thin, but it's surprisingly tough. Lore natural trained. While the membrane appears to be synthetic, closer inspection reveals that the material is organic in nature. It may actually have been alive when you first plummeted into the upper atmosphere, but it likely, quote-unquote, died shortly after it tore apart. So I'm guessing... This lore natural trained, because I have this, I'm getting extra lore on the items, which is pretty cool. Continue. Alright, so let me go. I'm definitely going to use that. I've got a shield equipped, I think. Don't I? I think I do. Yeah, I've got a regular shield. So I'm definitely going to, because this has better evasion, plus I get plus 2 might pool, which is pretty sweet. So I'm gonna sell that and raise some money to see if I can't go get some Wolverine's claws. I think. Yeah, let me go back and talk to this kid. And I still haven't found the girl that I'm looking for. Voice salutes you as you approach. Good to see you again, sir. How can I help? I had a talk with Lord Vunken. He agreed to call off the hunt for your stichus. His eyes widen, and he stares at you with obvious awe. Thank you. I thought nobody could tell the slaves' families what to do. He smiles. That means the stichus can stay here now. We'll keep him fed and out of sight. It was the right thing to do. And we appreciate it. He takes something from inside his shirt. It appears to be some sort of small device. Here, take this. I scrounged it a while back and never found a use for it, but you probably know all about these things. So I got some charm paste. Farewell. Well, let me take a look at this real quick. Confers charm paste. Plus 45% on persuasion tax. Persuasion task. It consumes movement, active until next sleep. Huh. So when I use this, I get a 45% on persuasion plus 45%, which is not insignificant, until my next sleep. Hmm. When applied to the teeth, it temporarily stimulates facial muscles. From a distance, this twitch can easily be mistaken for disarming and somewhat trustworthy grin. The perfume is pleasant from a comfortable distance and acts as a very mild intoxicant. It causes the user to seem more approachable and honest than they normally would. Charm paste eventually evaporates, leaving behind a pink, chalky residue. Its effects are limited and tend not to last much longer than a first impression. Huh. Interesting. That's some pretty sweet toothpaste. Okay, farewell. Wonder how much that's worth. Is that Numenera? It's a cipher. Worth 60. Okay. Close. Alright, I'm gonna level these guys up. And then next video, we'll go check out this tavern. Let's see if there's anything else I haven't done here yet. I still haven't found the girl. The girl's around somewhere. Oh, I need to go up here. So, next video, I need to make sure. Man, I've still got to go, I think, here. Can I even get across there? I'm not sure. But I need to go up here, and I need to go in the tavern. I got to find this girl. So, Reese or whatever her name is. So, anyway.
I heard you were quite a fighter in your day.
Age and wisdom have honed my skills, not diminished them.
The skills I've seen on display mainly involve preening and posing and running away.
How else would I have reached this age? Those who stand and fight don't live long.
All right, so when I want to get that other guy that went back to talk to the airship owner, I'm probably going to let Tiber go, and I'm going to bring that guy in. Because right now I have 3 Jacks and 1 Nano. And I'm kind of hoping that other guy's a Glaive, but we'll see. All right, but he could be a Jack the way he acts. He's kind of roguish. Let's, what do we got here? All right, so we're going to go up another tier. And all I can do is extra effort. Increasing your max effort level will allow you to spend more effort when performing tasks. So I'll go up to 3 from 2. That was the only thing I could do. And also get a singularity spike. What is this? At +2 relativistic damage to all attacks. Pretty cool. And I can... Oh, I'm tier 2. There's tiers, and then there's these steps. So I know that there's steps and then tiers. So I can't remember which is what. I can't remember if tier is kind of quote-unquote the level, or if it's the interim step, these little bubbles here. I can't remember. Anyway, choose one ability to learn. I'll take this. Trained without armor. 10% evasion. Plus 10% willpower when wearing no armor or light armor. Resourceful. Gain +1 training level and cipher use skill. Allows you to carry more ciphers. Warp dash. Teleport to a point and attack all enemies within short range of the point. That's kind of nice. Hedge magic. Automatically succeed on the next quick fingers or smashing task. Huh. Active until next sleep. Charm. Automatically succeed on the next persuasion, deception, or intimidation. Sucker punch. Attack that deals weapon damage +3. Illusory Warrior. Summon a psychic construct that helps you flank your enemies. This character can only summon one illusory warrior over time. It helps me flank my enemies. Kind of like resourceful. I kind of like warp dash. These are all good, actually. I don't really care about having extra ciphers is good, but I'm not really straining at the seams right now with ciphers. These are all good. Hedge, sucker punch. I'm not a glaive, but I don't really have a lot of good melee going on right now. Charm, hedge magic. I think I'm going to take the warp dash. I think that's going to be my thing. Ooh, I get a skill to increase. What do I want to... Endurance. Intimidation. Perception. Quick fingers. So many good abilities here. Ooh, mitigates penalties for equipped bonded artifacts. Huh. Nice. I can't remember if he has an artifact or not. I know one of my characters does. You know, these artifacts are pretty sweet, so I'm gonna take that concentration. Is she rocking one of these? One of my characters has got an artifact going. I think it's her. Okay, now she's up to tier 2. Stat pools, edge, ability, or skill. Let's see which. Let's take an ability. Infuse weapon. Choose a damage type and then make a weapon attack. Deal weapon damage of the chosen type, along with bonus effects. Warp dash. I'm going to give her the warp dash, too. It's pretty sweet. Alright. Is that everything? I think so. She's got warp dash. No, he's got warp dash. I think she's got warp dash too, doesn't she? No, I guess not. Dimensional superposition. That's what she's got. Okay. One of my characters has an artifact. I think it's her. Cloak. Yeah, bonded. Yep. So the negative one training level and persuasion, -3 on initiative. If this concentration skill I'm giving him... will start offsetting the negative. They'll start offsetting the negative effects of the artifact. So anyway, next video we will we'll check out this area, the tavern first, I'm sure, and then hopefully that area too. Maybe finish off Cliff's Edge. Thanks so much for watching the Shane Plays Let's Play series of Torment: Tides of Numenera. I'm still enjoying this game very much. I know that. I guess in the press or whatever, they're talking about that this game is not selling as well as they wanted it to. I really hate to hear that. I think it's not just an okay game. I think it's a very nicely done game. And I like the game a lot. I like the storyline. I like the interaction, the writing. I like the Numenera setting and the rules. And you know, this is just a cool game. So I hate to hear. I have a feeling that over time it'll be regarded with higher... you know, favor or, you know, opinion or whatever that it is now. But anyway, I think In Exile did a cool job with this game, and Monte Cook Games as well, which is the tabletop RPG that the Numenera, the game is using Numenera from Monte Cook Games. Anyway, thanks so much for watching. Appreciate any comments or a thumbs up if you could leave that on the video. It helps me out a lot. And maybe subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. We will catch you next time on Shane Plays.